Here is 44, and there's the Newcastle area. And again, the cell is moving probably just a little to the north of east and generally towards Moore and Bridge Creek and Newcastle. Let's take a look at the velocity mode here. And again, you can see there is rotation right there. There's an area where that red and green is right next to each other, and that's where the Doppler radar is showing us that there's a spin and a pronounced one. And so we're going to want to keep a very close eye on this as it moves towards that more populated 35 corridor. The movement here is now generally to the east at about 30 miles per hour. Now I want to take you farther southward and show you the tornado warning that is down in Garvey and Grady and Stevens counties. This going until 3:15, and you can see a huge supercell thunderstorm with very heavy rain and a hail threat. And let's zoom in a little bit and take a look at what's going on with the velocity there. And we are seeing a rotational signature on the southwest side of the cell right in here. So certainly there is potential for a tornado. Rotating wall cloud was spotted with this storm, and that is now generally going to be moving off towards the east as well, but a little bit to the north of the east. And we can take a look at some of the towns that are going to be potentially in the path of this particular cell as it moves eastward. Hope, I think that's going to be on top of you in very short order, so please be careful there in the Hope area. There's your movement, and in Hope, it's probably going to be coming in within the next 15 minutes. So now is the time to start thinking about taking shelter there in Hope as that storm continues to move in. Also, a very serious hail threat with a number of these storms, and we can take a look at the hail tracker, and that is now indicating the presence of 1 to 2 inch hail. See, 2.1 inches there. Not very far away from the Hope area, so that is greater than golf ball size hail. This, by the way, is now just to the west of 35. Tremendous amount of lightning along with that cell. And there are a whole series of storms right now, so there are a number, there are a string of severe thunderstorm warnings. And all of these cells are supercell storms, and they may all begin to rotate at some point. But again, we've got two main concerns, and we do have a tornado right now. And we've got a tornado in Newcastle, and we've got a live picture now coming from Newcastle, and there it is. There you see that wedge shape there. So folks, now is the time to take cover. If you are in Moore, if you're in Bridge Creek, if you are in Norman, Oklahoma, along 35 south of town, now is the time to take cover. We've got a tornado on the ground in Newcastle. It is moving towards the east at 30 miles per hour. A very dangerous situation there, right along 44, and we can, I believe, put the radar back up for you and show you exactly where the circulation is. Again, that's right along I-44 and very close to the Canadian River. So it's going to be right around 44 and Route 62 and also Route 37 crossing the Canadian River before too long. So right in here, there's 44 and there is the Canadian River. And you see the velocity signature, which is now more pronounced. So this storm is showing signs of strengthening already. And certainly that's what we're seeing in the video right there. This funnel reaching all the way to the ground there. This is a tornado in progress. We're not seeing a dust envelope as of yet, but you can see that condensation funnel reaching all the way to the ground there. So we do have an ongoing tornado there in Newcastle. And again, folks, you've been through this before. We know what this is all about in Moore and also in Norman, 99. And of course, just a few years after that in 2003, terrible tornadoes in this area. And this storm is now generally headed towards 35 and Moore and Bridge Creek. So now is the time to take shelter, folks. It's time now to get to your safe spot, lowest floor of your house, the basement. I'll put as many walls between you and the outside as you possibly can. You want to get away from the windows, as this is a very dangerous storm and very well formed, as you can see here. So we are going through it once again, looking at the rotational signature. Look at that, power flashes right there. You see that? So this storm is now doing damage to at least power lines and transformers there in the Newcastle area. And again, as of the latest scan on radar, was just west of I-44 and very close to the Canadian River. So probably right along Route 37, near the intersection of Route 37 and also Route 32. And then we'll be getting across the Canadian River into less populated territory, maybe crossing over Southwest 175th Street, Northeast 34th Street, and then also Northern Portland Avenue, as it moves along towards the east now, generally maybe a little north of east at about 30 miles per hour, but a well-formed tornado, as you can see. And this is rapidly evolving into a dangerous situation. Let's talk about the timing of this now. The storm is most likely on its current track and speed, most likely going to be in the Moore area at 3:15. So that's coming up in 15 minutes. Folks, that gives you 15 minutes to prepare for a possible tornado coming your way. Also, Clothier, probably about 3:22 Central Time. This storm is going to be moving in and is, again, rapidly developing. We are seeing a more robust rotational signature on the radar picture, and certainly the video is bearing that out as well. We're seeing a very well-defined tornado now on the southwest side of this supercell thunderstorm, and that is now located right along 44 and maybe just a little east of that. We're awaiting a new radar scan, and here's a look at the high-resolution radar. You can see that circulation there crossing I-44. Let's go over to MAX 7 and take a look at it right there. Here's the latest radar scan showing you again a very robust velocity couplet, much more well-defined than it was just moments ago, and right along 44, which is right in here, and again moving just a little bit to the north of east. So folks, again, in Moore and Norman, get ready. We've got a big storm that is moving in right now. Guys, over to you.
All right, thanks so much, Carl. As we continue to watch these live pictures from KFOR, they're up in the air over Newcastle, Oklahoma. We've seen power flashes. This is a dangerous large tornado that may actually be growing in size. It may actually getting even better organized. As you can see there, it is quite large as it is.
And Kelly reports that there may be a debris ball on the radar right now, indicating it is doing damage. It's near the Newcastle Casino at this time. The helicopter pilot who is in the air right now looking at this tornado saying it's getting bigger, it's getting wider, it's becoming more violent. So please, if you live in the area or near Moore, Oklahoma, please get to shelter immediately. It looks like it's becoming more rain wrapped at this time. It's huge. It's a huge tornado, and it may be getting rain wrapped and hard to see. So please, if you are in the path of this, get to your safety shelter right now, your safe house, where you need to go right now. Now it's northeast of the high school near Newcastle, and it's fixing to cross Interstate 44, and it's huge. It's wide. Right. It's a big tornado, and it's going to be capable of producing a lot of damage, and hopefully folks are seeking shelter at this time.
This is just south of Oklahoma City. It is moving toward the northeast at 20 miles per hour. Not only a tornado, as you're seeing right now live, but tennis ball hail is expected with this storm as well. So as Kim mentioned, Moore, Oklahoma, an area hard hit by tornadoes in the past, as well as Newcastle, where it is right now, Valley Brook. You should be seeking shelter right now, lowest level of your home or business, and away from the windows. And you can see right there from these live pictures of KFOR, this is a large tornado.
All right, we're going to go back to Carl Parker now. And Carl, KFOR reporter was saying there could be a debris ball on the radar. Are you seeing that right now?
Yeah, we definitely are seeing that. You see this ball? I'll show you this on the radar picture right here. That ball, that is most definitely the area right there where this storm is now picking up debris. Now, different modes that we can look at. One of them is called the correlation coefficient. You notice the black area right there. What the radar is doing is it's determining what targets are meteorological and which are non-meteorological, which is to say either structural debris or it can be trees and branches and things like that. And where you see that black, picking up those non-meteorological targets. So there is, in fact, a debris ball with storm. This is a very dangerous storm now crossing the I-44 corridor, and it looks like very close to the Canadian River as well, probably just getting ready to cross the Canadian River, and again moving a little bit to the north of east, and that's going to bring it over into the far western parts of Moore there, getting out perhaps towards Pennsylvania Avenue and also towards 160th Street, and then eventually moving more towards 164th. We've now got a tornado emergency for southern parts of Oklahoma City. Tornado emergency now in effect, and there we are looking at the live pictures. Folks, this is a large wedge tornado, and this is a really dangerous situation. You know the drill here. We've been through this before. If you are listening to us from Moore, from Norman, from Bridge Creek, now is the time to get to your safe shelter. There's no time to waste. The storm is now moving east at about 30 miles per hour, and this is a very mean, nasty, large tornado, much like we saw yesterday, now coming across the southern parts, the southwestern parts of Oklahoma City. Still awaiting a new scan on the radar. This scan that we're looking at is from 59 minutes past the hour, so it's still just a little bit old. There's a look at the velocity signal. And what you're seeing there is a robust velocity signature indicating very strong rotation. We can take a look at some of the values here. And we are seeing on one side about 69 knots, and on another side, we're seeing about 50 knots. That would be indicating somewhere around 140 mile per hour winds within this particular tornado. And so certainly that is enough to cause major damage. And you can see this very fat, very low wedge tornado, as we call it, and a very wide tornado at this point. Kim Kelly, over to you.
All right, Carl, we're getting some information as well that is possibly a half mile to a mile wide. And the helicopter that is giving us this video of this, or this live shot of this, is saying it's being pulled into the inflow, that it's such a strong inflow that it's having a hard time out there right now. And it's hitting a refinery right now, possibly, and some silos, kind of a farm area at this time. But again, you know, folks in Moore, I know this is reminiscent of 1999, May 3rd, the outbreak, and that wedge tornado that came at them, and my heart just goes out to them.
I know this is a destructive seeing here, a tornado emergency for not only Moore, but South Oklahoma City, but also in that tornado warning, Air Force Base, Valley Brook, in the path of this dangerous tornado as well. Unfortunately, we've already seen power flashes as well as debris showing up on the radar. Take this warning very seriously as it continues to move toward the northeast between 25 and 30 miles an hour. Just incredible pictures we're seeing right now live, courtesy of KFOR TV, Kim.
And it's a very violent rotation, what they're seeing from the helicopter. They're out right South 19th Street, approaching South 19th right now. It's going to be west of, it looks like 19th Street, be very close to it. But as you can see right now, a very large wedge tornado moving off towards the northeast, and again showing signs of being a violent tornado at this time. Power flashes. It looks like they're going to be hopefully trying to get away from this, as his helicopter pilot was saying earlier, that actually he was being drawn in and pulled in to the from the inflow of this very violent tornado.
Right. I mean, it's huge. And Carl, we're going to bring you back into this conversation, because it almost looks like when they zoomed out, we're seeing maybe some satellite tornadoes beginning to develop as well.
Yeah, that could be. And you know, I got to be totally honest with you. This is actually really upsetting to see this, because here we are. This is 2 days in a row, and this is we just got a new scan on the radar picture, and this is a very dangerous tornado. Now that couplet right there that you see, it's now east of 44. It is now generally headed towards Moore. That is a large, violent, dangerous tornado that is now coming towards Moore. So you've got no time, folks. You've got no time. Now is the time to get to your safe place in Moore as this storm moves in. And I fear that this storm is going to do a terrible amount of damage. This is a more populated area, though. The previous day's storm certainly did cause terrible problems. This is now coming into a more populated area of Oklahoma City, and it's an incredibly well-defined, violent tornado on radar. You see the circulation right in here. That is a robust circulation, and that is now, again, moving off towards the east, or a little north of east, and generally coming right towards Moore as we speak, and towards the 35 corridor. So again, folks, now is the time to take shelter, and don't waste any time. We'll look at the regular reflectivity mode, and we've got a very clear-cut debris ball here. You see this area of pink magenta. That is a debris ball. Now, that can be structural. It can also be trees. Look at that. Look at the size of the black right there. This is the correlation coefficient, indicating the non-meteorological targets, the stuff, basically, that is in this storm. And that could be trees, branches, or it could be structural. And certainly there's a lot of it right now showing up. This is a very pronounced debris ball, and it's coming over into the southwest side of the Oklahoma City metro area and towards Moore, Oklahoma. So please, folks, if you are in Moore, now is the time to get ready for this storm, and on the north side of Norman as well. Kelly, Kim, over to you.
Carl, very scary situation. That radar, very reminiscent of what we were seeing just yesterday in Oklahoma as well, where we saw so much damage. And in fact, we have Al Roker joining us on the phone.
We do. Al, we understand you are in Oklahoma City, and you're able to see this storm from where you are, maybe just the lightning at the time. Can you see the tornado?
Yeah. We cannot see the tornado from where we are, but it is torrential downpour right now. And I must tell you, this is the first time I've been in so sirens going off. I mean, they are going off and on now for the last, and you know, are pretty. I think people are taking this obviously very what happened yesterday, and now we've got this long track tornado with a huge, what looks like now about in a pretty popular. So it's a lot of folks are taking this really, really seriously.
And what's your plan, Al? Are you going to sit tight? Or are you guys trying to get some visual on this?
Well, we're trying to get a visual on it. Our live truck in Shawnee is wrapping is rolling up cable, because the big problem is if for all these areas that have been affected, there's so much debris that's been scattered from yesterday's tornadoes that, you know, it makes this even more dangerous, because you've got loose debris all over the place and there's no place for people to go. So it's a really scary situation right now.
And Al, you saw the damage firsthand in Shawnee, Oklahoma, where the National Weather Service says it was EF4 tornado damage, of course, EF5 being the worst. What we're seeing right now live, Al, appears to be a very well-organized tornado that could indeed be another EF4.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's headed for very populated areas. The one that's approaching Newcastle, it's heading near the high school, near the casino that's there. This is a serious situation. And you know, given that infrastructures have already been sorely tested with yesterday's storms, this is a really dangerous situation.
And of course, this gets closer to Interstate 35. 99, the May 3rd outbreak that it over that interstate did a lot of damage to cars, and I'm just really concerned. Hopefully they're trying to shut down Interstate 35 to be ready for this.
I mean, this is a really tangible situation going on. I mean, I'm looking right now at cars trying to make their way. I mean, there's mending on the roads. It's a torrential downpours right now.
And now, just to give everybody some perspective, we're looking just to the south of Oklahoma City, report of a large 34th Street heading right for Moore, Oklahoma. So again, we urge everybody to just get down, hunker down to the storm passes before you check it out.
And let's hope
these are really populated, densely populated areas. These are not rural. Shawnee is a more rural area. So while there was still a lot of damage, you know, when we're talking about someplace like Moore and Newcastle, these are really densely populated areas.
And Al, I think from that tornado outbreak in 99, they actually put shelters for people along the interstate if they get caught. Do you know anything about that?
I don't. I do not know what they're doing shelter-wise. Right now, I think 3 or 4 shelters that are open, but I don't know where they're located.
Okay, these are storm shelters. I think they actually put off the interstate that they can get to if you get caught on the interstate. Let's hope people are aware of that. But again, a large wedge tornado just south of Oklahoma City, heading towards Moore, Oklahoma, possibly crossing Interstate 35, and Norman may be in the path as well.
And Al, looks like they just updated the warning now. Portions of Carter, Garvin, Grady, Stevens under another tornado warning till 4:15 that just came in. We want to mention that to folks. But again, this is just incredible to see yet another tornado just 2 days in a row. Incredible.
And I think if there's one saving grace, it's that we were talking about this. Carl and Dr. Forbes and Dr. Postel were all talking about this late last week. People have had a chance to prepare for this. They've had a chance to get ready for this, and so they're taking, you know, people are not taking chances with this. They're taking this extremely seriously, and I think the fact that you saw yesterday, two fatalities, that I think that speaks to the fact that people are really taking this seriously.
And the fact that we have a visual from a helicopter seeing this large wedge tornado, we want to go live right now and listen in as they are watching this tornado.
Go get away from it or go below ground, storm cellar, basement, or safe room. It's the only option you have. This is all heavy debris. You see how it's turned now to the east. There's the Warren Theater. There's Moore High School. This is South 19th, South 34th. It's going to go right down through the neighborhoods between South 34th and South 19th Street. It will hit the Warren Theater. If it doesn't veer off, that's exactly where it's going to hit and cross I-35. Go, Mike Bennett.
Mike, okay. It's Mike is tracking right down 19th, approaching Santa Fe. We had to bail out of it because it was coming right at us. And we're getting ready to turn south here at South Moore High School. You can see our video. It's absolutely massive. It's just shredding everything in front of it. We're shooting out the side glass here right now, but it's just tracking straight east down 19th Street, uh, tra- track right over the area where we was at. Was within probably a quarter to half mile from it before we had to turn around and bail. Violent motion, a huge debris cloud wrapped around it. Zoom in tighter on that debris cloud. It looks like maybe, Mike, it may be actually starting to lift a little bit more north now than east. Hang on just a minute, Mike, I'm going to get out.
This tornado now is located at between Penn and Western. It's a mile wide, and it covers the whole area between Penn and Western at South 19th Street. At South 19th, this is a May 3rd type tornado. I would just venture to say it looks like it's about an EF4. It could be an EF5. Makes no difference. You got to be below ground. Interior closet or bathroom is not going to do it, or get out of its way. Storm cellar, basement, or safe room, or below ground of any kind. Do not be in your car near the tornado. Drive away from it if you have no option to save your life. Abandon where you are if you cannot get below ground. South 19th at exactly at Western Avenue right now is where that is. Go, Mike Bennett.
Okay, Mike. Yeah, it's mainly driving down 19th Street. I think it might be just a little bit north of 19th, but it's just pretty much moving east northeast. It's just getting more violent. It has absolutely no signs of weakening whatsoever. We're probably at least EF4 status here, whether it's as violent as this motion is. After the huge chunks of debris floating hundreds of feet in the air, whole trees floating hundreds of feet in the air. I can't tell you what kind of neighborhoods it's moving through, Mike. We're probably about a mile east of it right now, maybe east southeast of it, and where do we got to go?
Folks, over toward I-35, the Warren Theater should be completely evacuated by now based on our warnings. Again, you cannot delay. You can't think. You can't delay. You've got to act. You've got to act. You can't think or delay. You've got to act and act and act to save your life and your loved ones. You've got to act. Linda Cavanaugh had important information about the school systems going on. Linda, for the Metro.
We do have important information because parents are naturally worried, and we are hearing via Twitter that many students are being held at Westmore. They obviously can't release them into this storm, so we want you to be aware of that. Also, Middell students, they will not be released from
this. Okay, we're hearing about the situation at the schools. We're looking at a large tornado slicing right through Moore, Oklahoma, very reminiscent of what happened in May of 1999.
That's right. Tornado, and great advice to get under the ground if you can. The 99 tornado is the same thing. You have to be underground to be safe from this. That is the best place to be, is underground with a tornado like this, a large wedge tornado. I think they were saying that the schools, they're keeping the kids at the school to keep them safe. They're not releasing them. Parents, do not try to go to the schools now.
I mean, we're talking about the Warren Theater perhaps taking a hit. They had to evacuate that area of Moore, Oklahoma. We're on the south side of Oklahoma City, where this could be indeed an EF4 or possibly even an EF5 tornado, Carl, because this thing is a mile wide.
This is a terrible situation. This is very much like what we saw in May of 1999. This is a large, dangerous wedge tornado that is now coming into Moore. We can take a look at the velocity mode here, and we've got a very well-defined couplet showing gate-to-gate shear of 190 miles per hour. So winds here, 200 miles per hour. And you need to get to your safe place immediately there and more. This is going to be coming across 35 before very long. It's been coming right down southwest 19th Street. And you can see a monstrous storm now moving along towards the east, about 20 miles per hour. And it's certainly coming right into the heart of Moore, Oklahoma. You can see just how nasty that storm is. You can see a very large wedge there, cloud base very low to the ground. And that's going to cause extreme damage as it comes through. And again, now to the east of 35, and now right more golf and athletic club, then getting up towards the intersection of 19th and 35, maybe near the La Quinta there, and then moving up towards industrial and east. Avenue beyond that. So folks, this movement on this cell has generally been off towards the east, maybe a little north of east, and we can look at the radar here and show you what's going on. There's the debris ball. You see that big area of pink right there. So there is a lot of debris within this storm wrapping up, and there's the circulation right there. We can look at what is called the correlation coefficient. You see the big area of black that is showing up where that debris ball is, indicating the storm is full of trees and other debris. And as we look at the velocity signature, once again, an incredibly well-defined velocity signature that is now just west of 35. So the storm is getting ready to cross 35. And please, folks, now is the time to take shelter immediately. You do not have time to figure out whether or not this thing is going to be of serious or not for your location. Now is the time to get into your safe shelter. You want to get underground if you can with a storm like this. You definitely want to try to get underground, or if that's not an option, you want to get into the lowest, most interior part of your home and put as many walls between you and the outside as you possibly can. Extremely scary, dangerous situation now going on in Oklahoma City, very much reminiscent of what happened in 1999. Kim Kelly, back over to you.
Carl, we're getting word now that the police are trying to shut down parts of Interstate 35 and getting people off the interstate right now. Let's listen into KFOR.
Been watching it. Southwest 19th, we're getting sideways rain. We're blasting south now.
This now is a mile and a quarter wide debris ball. Looking at radar, it's a mile and a quarter wide, and it runs from South 16th Street down to South 166th. A mile and a quarter, and it's now going to cross. The Warren Theater is on the northern side of the debris ball. It's turned due east, going right down 119th. The heaviest debris is on 119th, and it is absolutely thick debris, as you would imagine, with an F4 Tornado Plus going through more right now. You cannot survive this if you're below ground. It is also heading up, may go as far north as Moore High School, but may go just south of Moore High School, but Moore High School is in immediate danger as well, and that would be a lot of the municipalities around downtown Moore. Let's go back to John Welsh and Bob Moore, Chopper 4.
Yeah, Mike, we're kind of losing it right now in this rain. We're still seeing a lot of power flashes, but it's in there, and I don't know if it's all the rain that's wrapped it up or the debris ball that just made it so hard to see. We're losing a lot of light here, so that's why everything's dark. Feeder band is continuing to lower, continuing to grow. This thing is not letting up from what we're seeing here on the air. Right now, I'm over Sooner Road. Actually, I'm over Sunny Lane Road and 164th Street, shooting back towards the northwest. So this is the area that it's coming to. And right there in the darkness, in the center of the cloud, you can see the power flashes. That's your tornado still on the ground. The debris ball and everything is so big from it that you can't see the shape of it. I'm going to have to make a turn here. But as you can see from our shot, this thing is a monster. It's so big, it's completely lost its texture. It's wrapped up in debris, it's wrapped up in rain, and this thing is just grinding right through Moore, just like it did, in 2000 or in 1999. So, where it's fixing to cross, what it looks like from our perspective, it's fixing to go north of the water tower there on 119th Street. So it looks like it's going to be just north of, 149th Street. Looks like it's crossing right north of 149th Street. They've got traffic blocked as far back here as Indian Hills Road by police, not letting anybody get in there. But it's tracking right on that line between, 134th Street and Moore, east. And we're getting
tons of power flashes. Take the south Doppler here. Take the south Doppler. Okay, the debris ball is 2 miles wide now. It's a 2 mile wide debris ball. Here's Moore High School. Right here, this is downtown Moore. It's crossing I-35 right now. This is 19th. This is South 4th. This is South 164th. This is Indian Hill. The debris ball is slightly over 2 miles wide. That's why you can't see it very well from the chopper. It has a massive amount of debris in it to where it's obscuring the entire tornado.
This is heartbreaking, Kelly, because it really is. Same place that got hit in 99 with an EF5, and again, this possibly doing EF5 damage at this time, which would be winds over 200 miles per hour, moving right over Moore, Interstate 35 right now, and you just got to pray. People are underground for this.
KFOR is reporting a debris ball 2 miles wide, and we're watching it approach Moore High School, where everybody's hunkered down right now, and hopefully in the best place they possibly possibly can be, Kim, because obviously if this is an EF4 or an EF5, the only place to be safe from this is underground.
That's right. Absolutely underground. And I think National Weather Service Office, Storm Prediction Center, all these folks are also, you know, worried about their loved ones. A lot of them live in Moore, Oklahoma, and I'm sure it's very hard for them to be working right now.
They're reporting lots of debris right now along 119th Street. We're talking about a tornado that is about a mile and a quarter wide that stretches from South 16th all the way to 166th Street. We're looking at Moore, which is on the south side of Oklahoma City. Just amazing pictures from our storm riders coming in as well.
All right, we have a picture, I think, from them coming in. All right, hang in there. It's going to be with us here in just a second.
Oh, wow.
Oh my God.
Wow.
I can't believe this. All right, Carl, what do you got for us?
It's just unbelievable, guys. It really is. As you say, it is heartbreaking. We've got some street level mapping now to show you exactly where this extremely large tornado is. This debris ball, as the meteorologist at KFOR mentioned, now 2 miles wide. So this entire thing is the circulation. And Brandon, let's zoom out just a little bit, give people an idea of where exactly this is. So you see Route 37. All right, so this is coming right across Route 37, which is right in here. Now let's tighten up a little bit. It's just beginning to come over into Eastern Avenue. So the areas that are going to be affected by this are going to be Bryant Avenue, and then also Sunny Lane Road, and then also Sooner Road, and over a very, very large area from as far north as perhaps 27th Street all the way down to perhaps Indian Hills Road or even farther southward. So this is a huge system that is now coming in, a tremendous velocity couplet, the tremendous rotation as much as perhaps 200 miles an hour, now crossing 35 there in the Moore area, and just absolutely devastating. It's really, really hard to watch this, and hopefully everyone that is in this area has gotten into their safe place, because this is going to be a long-lived tornado, unfortunately, because of its size. A lot of times tornadoes are in and out pretty quickly, but in this case, because this thing is so large, it's a massive tornado, it's going to last for a while, and it's going to cause a tremendous, extreme damage as a result. There you're looking at the live pictures, and at this point it's difficult to actually pick out where that wedge is, because we've got such haze there, but you can see that dark mass that is now on the ground, and again crossing 35 in Moore. There's another look at it from a 3D perspective, and now in the heart of Moore, and we've got a brand new scan on the radar here, and that the heart of that tornado now crossing from downtown Moore and just a little farther to the south and to the east. So we're getting out now down Broadway and again towards Sunny Lane Road, out along 134th, along 149th, along 34th, and also getting out towards Sooner Road as well. And you can see that just a tremendous size of the system. And there again is that velocity couplet showing you just how dangerous this particular storm is. And joining me right now is Brian Norcross. And Brian, this is very difficult to see. This is the very same area that was hit by a tornado in 1999.
Yeah, we're just looking at the track of the May 3rd, 1999 tornado. And 119th, identify 119th on there, Carl, is, I think that's that main, there's Southwest 19th Street.
Just to the north of downtown, north of downtown.
So can we go to the north on this map here a little bit? Okay, so 119th is up here. Mm-hmm. So the tornado in 1999 actually crossed north of where this one's going. So go ahead and put a marker where we think the tornado was located, down here to the south of there of 37, right in there, right. Then, and the Moore tornado, if you want to draw a line, kind of went across 119th and Moore. So it went like that. So this is on the south side of Moore. Mm-hmm. The 1999 tornado went right through the center of Moore, but actually the city has developed larger. This is a southern suburb of Oklahoma City, kind of midway between downtown Oklahoma City and Norman, Oklahoma. So as you drive south down 35, out of Oklahoma City proper, you come to Moore as a big suburb, and then you come to Norman, which is where the Storm Prediction Center is, and where, as Kim and Kelly were talking about, a lot of people that are in the tornado business are working. So obviously they're very familiar with this.
Now we're getting some live pictures of some of the damage there from south of Oklahoma City, and not exactly sure what we're looking at in those pictures, but certainly this is an incredibly dangerous situation, and the storm now coming right through Moore. It is moving to the east at about 20 miles per hour, and it's a very large tornado, violent tornado, and is going to be moving out now just right along 149th and continuing out towards Sooner Road, and then getting out towards Lake Stanley Draper. So if you were in the area of Lake Stanley Draper, that is the next area that this tornado is going to be headed towards. And, you know, with a tornado like this that is so large, it's not a hit or miss sort of a thing. It's going to leave a wide swath of destruction, Brian.
I mean, you hate to speculate about what we're looking at. It looks like it's a divided highway. It might be 35. I mean, because we know the tornado went right over Interstate 35. Mm-hmm. There we could see damaged cars. Obviously, the police were stopping the traffic on 35, trying to keep people right out of the way of it. If we can get word from our storm chasers there to exactly where they are, that would be helpful so we could help folks. But you see clearly a divided road.
Yeah,
down there. So which exactly road, we're not sure. But this is paralleling, it looks like moving east at this point, but very, very slowly, extraordinarily slow for storms of this size and dimension.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And Brandon, maybe you can tell me what the latest motion on the storm is, how quickly it's moving off towards the east here. But you can see that circulation now basically right along Eastern Avenue as of the latest scan on the Doppler radar, right along Eastern Avenue, and then also right along 4th Street there and moving towards 8th Street. So this is basically hitting the south side of the Moore area, and an extremely dangerous tornado. It's not really showing any signs of letting up at this point.
So 3:25 was when our scan, that's central time, central daylight time, the scan came in. So now we're coming up on 3:30 central time. So this is 5 minutes. So with the storm moving to the east, it's actually, we know now that it's past eastern, assuming it's moving much. Brandon, do we know?
Oh, we got a new scan. We just got a brand new scan there, Brian.
Oh, there it is. Okay, yeah. So there you saw it. Then you saw it.
And that's considerably farther east, actually. That's now to 77, Route 77 and Sooner Road. So again, this is going to be headed generally towards Lake Stanley Draper. If you are around Lake Stanley Draper, it is time now to get to your safe shelter and to take cover immediately. Ladies, over to you.
All right, guys, keep an eye on that radar. We want to talk to storm chasers on the ground.
All right, storm rider Simon Brewer is on the phone with us. And what's your vantage point? What are you seeing, Simon?
Hello, we're on I-44 and Sooner Road. It's now crossing Sooner Road. It's doing damage. We've seen some power flashes. It's a wedge-shaped tornado crossing Sooner Road. The eastern side of the tornado is now over the road.
Simon, we're looking at your live picture right now. Have you seen much in the way of damage?
We can't see specific damage. We can see the power flashes, and it's definitely going through neighborhoods. Justin actually has a house that is very close to this damage path. It's probably about, I'd say this tornado is about a half mile wide looking at it right now.
Wow. So are you in the path of it, or where are you?
We're north of the tornado. The tornado is actually starting to tighten up. We're north of the tornado, maybe about a mile and a half north of the tornado, maybe 2 miles north of the tornado. And it's definitely a strong tornado, and it's going to be south of I-40 or I-240 for about.
All right, how would you rate this compared to some of the tornadoes you've seen? What do you think about this one?
Well, it has a lot of debris around it, so it's kind of hard to see the violent motion in it. For example, the tornado yesterday that hit Shawnee was appeared significantly more violent than this tornado. But it had a lot less debris around it, a lot less rain around it.
Right.
This one is much larger, has a lot more rain wrapping around it, has a lot more debris wrapping around it. It's going through many more neighborhoods.
Right.
So it's hard to see the what we call the helical motion on the on the side of the tornado, which really gives away the signs of how violent a tornado can be. And this one is definitely a monstrous tornado going through a heavily populated area. And it looks like it's about a quarter of a mile wide at the moment. And it's starting to take more of a stovepipe-ish shape instead of the wedge shape that it had earlier. And we're going east on Interstate 240, and it's maybe about a mile and a half south of us.
All right, Simon, keep an eye on it. Stay safe out there. Just an awful situation we are watching right before our eyes. This is live, folks, just to the south of Oklahoma City near Moore, Oklahoma. We urge everybody to continue to seek shelter.
And it's now east of Interstate 35. Tinker Air Force Base may be the next in line, so please take shelter immediately. We want to listen live right now to KFOR.
Xanax Lake. So typically these tornadoes are going to find the path of least resistance. They're going to stay in all that low ground, and so it's going to come up here, and there's the water tower and the water treatment plant that is on the southeast side, or the southwest side of Lake Draper. It appears at this time it's going to go just north of that, and it's going to continue to track over the top of that, so we'll see what it does when it crosses the lake, but it's continuing to rip and grind all these trees up as it's crossed Sunny Lane, continuing to go eastbound towards Draper, and it looks like it's going to be about north of 149th Street here, Mike.
Indeed, and it's now it's approaching Air Depot. It's approaching Air Depot. Air Depot, and we're getting pretty a little closer to South 89th Street. We're down there at about 120th South, 130th South. But it is now between Sooner and Air Depot, and it is going to go over the northern or central parts of Draper Lake here coming up. Go, John.
It's going out a little bit. Hey, look, I got to move here real quick. Hey, but while I'm flying away from it, look at it, Mike. It's lightening up.
Wow.
It's becoming more of a barrel-shaped. It's the wedge is decreased a little bit. It's slowly turning. It almost looks like it's turned to the southeast. So I'm breaking away from it as fast as I can because it's getting a little closer for my comfort. But it's definitely, it's changed shape, it's barreled, it's gotten a little higher, the base has risen. The base is probably about 1,300 to 1,400 feet above the ground, so it's just 300 or 400 feet below
okay.
me. And as you can see, it's got a definite cone shaped on it. And it appears it is
we are listening live to KFOR right now as we are tracking a large, violent, and possibly deadly tornado just south of Oklahoma City.
All right, I want to go right now to Carl Parker, who's watching this very closely. And Carl, could this be a good sign?
Well, you know, we have seen a little bit of a lessening in the velocity, but this has been such a dangerous tornado so far that that's not going to help very much. Right now, the velocity indicating that we've got a storm that's probably on the order of about 140 miles per hour or something like that, maybe a little bit less than that. And that is now headed towards Lake Stanley Draper. So Stanley Draper Lake is the area that's going to get hit next by this storm. And then, Brian, it's going to be southeastern Oklahoma City. It looks like areas primarily south of 240, the storm does not change direction very much.
So it looks like it'll go south of Tinker Air Force Base and north end of the lake there, and then into a much less populated area. And you can see here on the velocity, if you were watching a moment ago, there were much more pronounced bright greens and bright reds
exactly.
in a much bigger area. So as, in fact, you can see, it looks like it's trying to rope out there. The tornado is getting
wow.
much
Look at
smaller
that.
Diameter. In fact, you
That's
can see it.
It
kind of dissipating here right
wow.
before our eyes. Now,
wow.
now that doesn't mean that this threat is gone.
That's exactly right.
Right, right?
Yeah.
Because we saw yesterday, sometimes these, in fact, these supercells always cycle to some
right.
degree,
yeah.
right? Now, will that cloud base descend again? Will it drop another tornado? Remains to be seen, but boy, for the folks there near that lake, and there, we just got a new scan just came in there. Near the lake there, this is fantastic news because yeah. whatever is left of it is dramatically less intense. In fact, it looks like maybe the tornado has even dissipated, although we're still seeing a pretty good rotation aloft with this system.
Yeah, these things maintain their intensity when you've got a perfect balance of an inflow of warm and humid air and then cooler air that wraps around the backside of the system. But there are times when the cooler air will win out, essentially. It will overcome the warmer air, the inflow, choke off that inflow, and the result is what you see right there when the storm begins to weaken. But there is still a very strong mid-level and even lower level rotation here, so it can go through this whole process and then once again begin to take in that inflow, and the tornado can develop once again. That's exactly what we saw, by the way, yesterday in Edmond and Arcadia on the north side of town. We saw a weaker tornado that dissipated, and then a very strong tornado developed in the wake of that.
And what we see on the velocity on the radar is still rotation aloft, so we know that this the supercell still has the potential to produce a tornado, but clearly on the video, the tornado does not seem to be. Now that doesn't mean that there is no rotational wind,
right.
but we clearly are not seeing the kind of strength of a system that we saw before. I was just going to make a point, and I forgot exactly what my point was going to be. But the news at this moment is much better for the folks downstream in the southeastern, what's called on the map here, southeast Oklahoma City, which really is a much less populated suburban area of Oklahoma City. It's actually got a lot of trees in it, and you can see kind of on the helicopter shot there,
yeah.
looking over on the other side of the lake and downstream of this tornado.
Yeah, and unfortunately, this thing was really peaking right at the moment that it was coming through one of the more heavily populated areas south of Oklahoma City, right through two more, which is the same area that was hit in 1999 and not very far away from the area.
Town.
At least the
sound,
same not the exact same part of town, right. But at least the same region of the metro area. And unfortunately, it was a violent tornado as it was coming through there. And I fear that we're going to be hearing about quite a bit of destruction and damage.
I think that's certain. I remember what my point was. So the tornado is like a spinning top. You could have a spinning top, but if the top runs into almost any little thing, it can get disrupted. Tornado right. requires, as you said, and put it very well, a perfect balance. Look, this is live, obviously, on one of the major highways. I tried to catch that exit sign there. And do we know which highway? Is this on 35? I wonder.
This is on 44.
On 44. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's try and keep an eye out here for an exit sign. Obviously, still a lot of dark skies and violent weather potential in the Oklahoma City area. But, Carl, the velocity looks very, very different than it did just a little while ago. The couplet is barely
Yeah,
visible.
That's really remarkable. In fact, we can step back here. I can take a look at the velocity mode and show you how this thing has progressed. And I don't know if we can take a look at Max 7 here, or excuse me, take a look at Graphic 16, and we can see where there was an incredibly well-defined rotational couplet right there in Moore, came right over Moore, and then we step forward here. You see the scan still pretty well-defined right there, and then still so right around Highway 77. That is the most recent scan right there, and there is still evidence of that, but you can see that it's not as tight as it once was.
All right, we have here where we can take a look at the comparison of the tracks. So south of town there, you see where this tornado has gone in this area down here, and there is the 1999 track that went more of an angle across Moore. So there you see the cell. It's that cell as you track that across south of downtown Moore, Oklahoma. With the you see the word city up there. That's Oklahoma City. So downtown Oklahoma City is well to the north. So this is moving through the south metro and now tending to dissipate out here, well southeast of town and south of Tinker Air Force Base.
Yeah, and maybe we can have our guys get a look at where the, I believe the 2003 storm took a path that was more similar to the one that's occurring right now, farther to the south and a little bit more to the east. But they got two very strong tornadoes within 4 years, and rather remarkably, there was a tremendous difference in the amount of fatalities and injuries between those two storms, though there was a similar number of homes that were destroyed, but it was that people were most likely much more aware of what was going on after 1999.
I mean, one thing that is true about in Oklahoma City, there is no place better prepared for this.
Right. Right,
the way the media works, our partners there at KFOR are just spectacular at this,
yes.
As they are at other Oklahoma City media. The way people live tornadoes and respond to tornadoes, really as a result, as you said, of the 1999 Moore tornado. They've changed their thinking. Many, many more people have put safe rooms in their homes.
Yes.
And as I'm sure the thinking in Joplin will change and has changed after the Joplin tornado.
Absolutely. Ladies, over to you.
All right. Thanks, guys. Great expert analysis on this tornado that has now seemed to have dissipated, but still capable of producing a tornado.
And we've got our own Weather Channel crews on the ground as well. We want to get to Dr. Greg Forbes joining us on the phone in Elmore City, Oklahoma. Greg, what have you seen?
Well, we were on a storm that was farther down to the south. It did produce a tornado, but when we saw what a monster storm was in progress up near Moore, we have diverted and are heading back that way. We anticipate we'll probably be doing some damage coverage. We've been watching on our radars that debris ball that came from west and west-southwest of Moore, right across the south side of Moore. And our radar is a little slow out here with not the greatest of internet reception, but we do now see the weakening that has taken place. Let's hope that continues. But it still has a pretty good hook echo on it. I wouldn't be at all surprised to see that this storm would re-intensify over to the in the vicinity of, unfortunately, it's coming up that probably just a little north of Bethel Acres where we were reporting from this morning, but it's still well west of there.
All right, Dr. Forbes, we're getting pictures of some of the damage out there right now. Looks like a lot of trees debarked and a lot of homes and cars totally destroyed. You know, seeing this damage right now, I mean, this is pretty incredible. This does look like what we saw in Shawnee a little bit. And look at maybe Interstate 35. It's possible. I'm looking at Interstate 35 maybe, and cars totally destroyed and flipped over on this interstate. I believe this is Interstate 35. A lot of cars are overturned. Either it's 44 or 35. I'm not sure which one it is. But, you know, the debris ball that, you know, they're claiming 2.25 mile wide. Have you ever, was Joplin like that, or was a Tuscaloosa that large, the debris ball?
The debris ball on Tuscaloosa was about 2 miles wide, but it was a combination of debris in the inner part and then some rain that was also wrapping around the outer part. So that could be the case here. I was thinking that probably the main core of the debris ball, as it was around the Moore area there, I was measuring was about a mile and a half wide. So I heard the storm riders saying they thought visually that the tornado was probably about a half mile. So I think probably once again we have some a debris ball on radar that was a little bit bigger that may have had a little bit of precipitation and or dust that was wrapping around and maybe the tornado wind's not quite that big.
Greg, we're looking at incredible pictures from KFOR. Neighborhoods just seeing a lot of damage. We want to listen in now to KFOR.
Center, as you can see, the track from here, it went just south of 4th Street, and it's going to go right towards the, I'm getting hit by some heavy rain here, it's going to go right towards the Walmart, the neighborhood market. The neighborhood market is on Southeast 4th and Eastern. The track went just south of it, and we're getting hit by some RFDs. This track went just south of it and went straight to the west, and it's going to cross another housing addition right there. I believe it's Apple Creek, and it's going to come up on passing a Tower Road, and it's going to cross the train tracks there. From the train tracks, we're still in between 12th Street, or we're between 19th Street and 4th Street. It went straight across there, hit those houses. It ran right along the highway, and looks like it went over. If you'll go to your right, Travis, we'll go from Lowe's to the Warren Theater. Looks like it tracked just north of the Warren Theater, and it hit the Warren Theater. It hit the bowling alley. It hit the bank. It hit the post office. And right there on the corner is the Norman Regional Healthcare Center. It's the hospitals right there on 4th and Telephone Road. It hit that. We're going to continue to go to the west. We have several housing additions right here. We've got a trailer park. And this thing just completely destroyed right here as we go from Santa Fe. And again, I'm between 19th Street and 4th Street and Moore. We're still headed west. Let me zoom in here. And look at that school. Look at that school, guys. Oh, my God. Right there. Keep coming back to your left, Travis. Keep coming back to your left. If you guys can see this, I don't know how to explain it, how to describe it. This is terrible. This is war zone terrible. This school is completely gone. Now we're going to stay right here. It's right to the right. If you'll pan back to the right, you're going to see the school. That was it right there. That's what's left of it. And you can see all the housing additions that are, all this house right here is completely destroyed. And, you know, guys, we're going to have to definitely police and everybody en route. That is a school. No, that's a storage unit. Come back to your left. If you guys are still with me here, this damage path is right there on the top right of your screen. There's the school. I'm unsure the exact name of it, but that's going to be on. It's going to be south of 4th Street. It's going to be east of Santa Fe. Whatever school that is, it's going to be. It is like you see. Completely destroyed as kids run up to hopefully their loved ones. But this whole area right here, guys, is it's completely destroyed. The houses are destroyed. They're completely leveled. We're gonna just stay right here in this area. This is the hardest hit area. Police have folks stopped right here on Santa Fe in between 19th Street and 4th Street. This is by far the hardest hit area. As you can see, we've got more police out there trying to find everybody, or you know, doing what they do best is rendering aid. And all the kids are running. We'll stay here for a little bit and see if we get some damages or if we get some a report of how everybody's doing. I'm just going to talk to you as we kind of stay on this shot. As we continue to look back towards the west, this whole area is just completely demolished. Every house in this area is leveled. I'm fixing to cross. I'm just north of 149th Street, and this whole area right here, this neighborhood in between Santa Fe and Western.
John, can you hear me?
Police are driving through. They're looking for people. Yeah, I can hear you. Linda, can you hear me?
Yes, John, we need to let people know that they're going to set up a search and rescue headquarters at the Warren Theater. We saw your video from before where it showed the Warren Theater was in relatively good shape compared to many of those buildings around it. You're doing a terrific job of bringing home the misery that's happening right now. We need the prayers of everyone for more Oklahoma again. Now, you're telling me that this is video of parents reuniting with their children. I'm told that that's a school in the background. You can see police officers all around, but look at the ground on that shot previously before he pulled out. Go ahead, John.
Let me show you another school. It's right out my door, Travis. If you keep coming around, perfect. Now straight down and to your left, right there. That's another school, Linda.
Oh my goodness.
And that one looks like, I don't know what to say. That one looks harder. It looks harder hit than any of them before.
Oh my goodness.
As a parent, this is kind of hard to report on. We're going to stay in the air. We're going to show you, these pictures tell everything. The Orr Family Farm, if you guys are familiar with that, it's going to be on 10, I think, in 149th. It's right out the left.
And Travis, John, have Travis pull back into that school. Those appear to be the first people who've been able to make it to the scene, walking carefully through that debris. You see other people now, they're gathering. Of course, we're trying to find out if the kids were being sheltered there or someplace else. Our thoughts and prayers are with everybody in the Moore area. The devastation is complete. One of our cameramen called it atomic bomb-like devastation.
It's just unbelievable. And again, we're trying to figure out right now, were the kids there? And, of course, they're looking right now, looking for, not looking for fatalities or survivors. We're hoping that the kids were gone, but we're not sure at this point. We're getting as much information in as we can.
Second of two schools destroyed in Moore, Oklahoma, along with a huge section of residential housing. If we go back to those shots in the future, you'll see that the ground literally is nothing but mud. There is nothing on the ground.
It looks like May 3rd, what we saw on May 3rd of 1999.
Go ahead.
I'm being told, guys, that is the Plaza Towers Elementary School. So if you guys
Plaza
can find
Towers.
Out.
Okay.
Plaza Towers, and I'm unsure of this other school here. It's going to be on 149th and in between Penn and Western. The Orr Family Farm, if you guys are familiar with that area, is right behind that. The family farm is trashed. This whole area between Penn, you have Western and Santa Fe. Those 3 miles or those 2 mile sections right there. Guys, everything is leveled for almost the whole mile. Travis is kind of showing you some wide shots here. This is unbelievable.
And John, this is reminiscent of the May 3rd, 1999 storm that moved through the Moore area and literally tore out entire neighborhoods and
housing
additions.
That's what it looked like. That's exactly what it looked like.
And we're looking at the same thing right there. We pray to God that those people were somehow underground when that hit. On May 3rd, 1999, people were diving into manhole covers trying to get away from the storm if they didn't have underground shelter. Mike Morgan was warning these folks at least 30 minutes before the storm hit, to leave the area if they did not have underground sheltering in place. We hope that that's the case. We hope the death toll does not resemble that May 3rd tornado.
Mike, was that the exact path of the May 3rd tornado?
This was along the exact path, and then as it came deeper into Moore, it's a little bit on the southern sides of the May 3rd path. And I don't want to make comparisons too much to May 3rd, just in terms of, what I'll say is this tornado is, I believe, wider. And I think that I think we're going to find that there are many more structures that have been hit compared to May 3rd from what you and I are seeing right now live from Bob Moore Chopper 4. May 3rd took some areas that weren't developed back in 1999 mm-hmm. through Moore. I think the total was 6,000 some odd structures that were damaged or destroyed. I believe the amount may be more with this particular tornado today.
And you look at that scene of destruction there and the small figures of those rescuers. working frantically here, looking here. Just, where do you begin? I mean, that's the question. Where do you begin on something like this?
Mike, how long was that tornado on the ground?
Well, it was on the ground for just under 1 hour. Linda, it set down just southwest of west of Newcastle, and then went to that large wedge. And I think the peak width on it was about a mile and a half wide. That's one thing that I'm noticing looking at these pictures is the debris path appears to be significantly wider through more than May 3rd, 1999. And again, most of this path is just on the southern sides of the May 3rd path.
We just saw somebody there obviously in distress, as any of us would be walking upon a scene like that. Looking through the rubble there.
Again, let us repeat that Warren Theater is going to be the staging area for search and rescue. We know that a lot of people are going into that area, but please, only people who are supposed to be there in terms of search and rescue, fire departments, police, stay out of the area otherwise. It's nothing but dangerous, and the police need their room to be able to get in there and try to save anybody who may be in that debris. And that, of course, right now is their utmost importance.
And again, we're looking at the Plaza Tower School, is what we're being told that is. We do not know if the kids were in there or not. We're hoping they weren't, of course, but we're continuing to try and get you more information on that.
John's moving back around to the other side.
That is a huge destruction path.
But there's still trees there. I'm not sure that that is the destruction.
Just north.
Because on the other shots, there were no trees anywhere. And that's what we're looking at. Mike, there we go.
Let me break away here for just a second. Let's go to what we have going on right now. I need to talk about a couple areas here, and I'm only going to talk about the areas that are the most danger right now. I will tell you this storm is recycling now in southeastern Oklahoma County. Let's go to the North Doppler and take a look at it. Tornado warning does continue. It's south of Hera right now and to the southwest.
Again, we're listening in on KFOR coverage of the devastating tornado that went right through Moore, Oklahoma. We've understood that a couple of schools have been destroyed. The Warren Theater is where they are organizing a search and rescue at this point.
And from the aerials, they're thinking the path of destruction could be more than a mile wide from what they're seeing, possibly rivaling or even being greater than the 1999 May 3rd tornado that moved through Moore, Oklahoma. Total devastation is what they're seeing in many neighborhoods. Again, as Kelly mentioned, two schools hit very hard, the Plaza Tower School being one of them. And they're asking everybody to don't go anywhere, stay where you are. Let search and rescue get in there. Let the police get in there and do what they need to do.
As this tornado was coming through, it was at least a mile wide. And unfortunately, we did hear reports that it may have also affected a hospital in Moore, Oklahoma as well. We are working to confirm that information. But again, many neighborhoods just devastated. You can see the emergency personnel on the scene right now, cars that were demolished and buildings just completely flattened.
And we're getting word that a lot of people are trying to get to this area, probably to see what their house looks like, to get to family members. Their emergency manager is saying, please don't go anywhere. Do not go, because right now you're clogging up traffic and emergency vehicles cannot get there.
We want to listen back in to KFOR's coverage.
And friends who are in that area, we can assure you police will be down there. There is a whole stream of red and blue lights heading to Moore, Oklahoma right now. At this point, there is very little you can do, very little chance that you'll even be able to get into those areas. So,
and again,
hearts are with you.
Absolutely. And they said, we appreciate those who want to help and those who are frantic about family members, but they've got to get in there right now.
A post tornadic fire. Here we go. Come to your left.
Okay, John's reporting a post-traumatic fire that may have broken out.
Post-tornadic fire, yeah.
There it is.
It's a gas leak. Believing it's a gas leak.
Okay.
So please, this area remains dangerous. Stay out of the area. We don't know exactly what is on fire there, but you can tell.
It looks like it's a structure.
It's a house. Yeah. It's a house. It's on fire.
Yeah. John's reporting it's a house. John, can you see emergency crews getting into those areas at all yet?
Yes. You know, here's the deal. The toughest part and the hardest part that they really need to get to, there's so much debris that, you need a monster truck to get through.
Yeah.
There's cars upside down. There's, debris. There's houses and there's whole houses in the road. So the hardest part they need to get to, they can't get to. But yes, there are a lot of people on the roadway. And here's what part of the issue is the police did a great job stopping people and not letting them even get in the damaging path. And so what they've done is now these people that were in their cars are still congested on the roadway. And now they have to get out of the way. And it was bumper to bumper on almost all these roads are four lane roads, so there were full. north and south of this damage track. So now they have to find a way to get out. But in some of these neighborhoods, I am seeing a lot of people driving around, and it could be that's their house they're wanting to check on somebody, or you know, maybe they're just looky-loos. At this time, I don't know. And I'm sure everybody wants to help, but the biggest issue here is the congestion of traffic.
Yeah, you're right, John. We want to tell you about, there's another area that is being open right now, 89th and Western, Oak Crest Church of Christ, for anybody who does not have power. If you know somebody who does not have power, because if they don't, they're probably not hearing us right now. If you know somebody who doesn't have power, if you've been talking to them on the cell phone, tell them that the Church of Christ at 89th and Western is having some folks come in there and stay with him. That's a refuge center.
Your heart hurts looking at these images. We ask all of you to keep all of these people in your prayers. We have no indication yet of death toll, but we can tell you that just by looking at devastation, unless people heeded the warnings and left the area or were underground, the chances of survival for that type of storm are bad.
Well, those are just foundations.
Well, see, look at the ground behind it. There's just nothing. It's like those foundations are just scabs on the landscape.
That's the fire that John was talking about a minute ago. And I know things are wet there. It will keep the ember problem down a little bit, but we sure don't need any fire spreading right now to any of these other areas.
Also need to tell you that Oklahoma City Schools has alerted us to the fact that they are releasing their students. The buses will begin bringing your children home. So Oklahoma City parents, welcome them home with hugs. And, you know, it's a scary situation for all of these kids who are being held away from their parents. But as you can see, the devastation at the two schools in Moore, Oklahoma, the Plaza Tower Elementary, and we don't have the name of the other one just yet, was complete. So we have our fingers crossed that those kids were somehow protected or were already gone from the scene. But we do have rescue crews going through the areas right now looking for those who may have survived.
And we're waiting. I know a lot of you folks out there are wanting to know what the injury figures are, or we pray no fatalities, but if are there any fatalities, we'll let you know just as quickly as we find out. We certainly want to let the emergency officials do their jobs. This is a search and rescue right now, and they've got to get all these folks that they can rescue that may be trapped in the rubble, like we saw yesterday on a much smaller scale than this, but what they were doing yesterday.
John, you did a great job just a few minutes ago for those folks who are just now joining us of moving down the tornado path. Can you do that one more time so that people who are familiar with the Moore area can see where that storm went and what it did? And you are so good about this area because you live down there, and I know that you fear for your family right now, but thank you so much for staying in the air and helping us out with these pictures, because I think it's what our viewers need to see as this storm continues to move. Now Mike's going to come back in just a moment with other areas that may be of concern to viewers where this tornado is heading, recycling and heading again. But if you'll take us back to where the tornado entered Moore and show us what you see and describe it again for us, I think that would be priceless.
And you might give us the cross streets too, John.
Yeah, coming back to the left. All right, coming back to the left, we're going to have the we're going to have Penn, and in Oklahoma City, it's going to be 134th Street. Yeah, that, but hang on, come back to the right, sorry. And right there, that intersection, that's Penn and 134th. And back to the left, there's a lot of scabbed landscape. Homes out here kind of on acreage, so there's not the population density is not there. So we're going to start right here at Penn and 134th Street. We're going to pan back to the right. So in Moore, this is going to be 4th Street for you guys we're fixing to come into. And as you can see, all the houses right here, primarily roof damage. Just to the north of that, as you can see, right there, there used to be, I'm drawing a blank here because I'm not used to seeing it without anything.
Oh,
I believe
gosh.
There's a convenience store right there. And then just in the north side of that, that oval track, that's at the Orr Family Farm. So right there, we're going to travel down 149th Street here, which is going to be just south of the Warren Theater. We're in between 4th and 19th Street. We're tracking along. There's the new Dick's that they built, the Target, the Home Depot.
Are those the buildings we see destroyed in right there? That was a Home Depot and a Target. Is that what you're saying?
No. This right here, that's the Plaza Towers Elementary School.
Plaza Towers, okay.
We're right now, we're just north of 19th Street, south of 4th Street,
okay.
And we're fixing across Santa Fe. If you guys are familiar with this area, there's like the golf course here on the south side of the road.
Mm-hmm.
All this, where the house is burning at, in that neighborhood that's just north of, there's a Dan McGinnis, an Irish pub right there, just north of that. We're going to continue to go to the east over several other schools and homes that, if travels go just to the left, just a bit. That's that first elementary school we showed you right there. Now we'll back out and we'll continue to come. Now this, where we're coming to right now, is just on the south side of the Moore Warren Theater. This is going to be on Telephone Road in between 4th Street. That's what? Yeah, we're coming up on
So there's the Warren over on,
in between 4th Street. There's the Warren right there.
Yeah, right.
If we're going to look to your left, Travis will pan back out, and that's the Norman Hospital right there. Right in front of that is going to be the bowling alley, the AMC bowling alley, if you guys are familiar, right there.
So
in front
it's
of that
gone.
Was, I believe it's, yeah, it's gone.
You can still see
in front
the
of that was
there.
A Century 21 office. To the left side of that was a bank. And now we're crossing I-35. We're just south of 4th Street, and we're continuing to see this is another housing addition that comes into the area. We're coming up to where more annex this property right here. They're putting a park in. We're crossing the railroad tracks now. We're still headed eastbound.
Okay.
We're coming behind the alternative school here in Moore. We're coming behind the neighborhood market, and we're fixing across Eastern. Just to the left is Eastern. Right there on the left side of your screen is Eastern and 4th Street. The tornado just tracked just south of Eastern, and it's continuing pretty much eastbound right now. The next building you're going to see in the top left of your screen is the Brink Junior High. Came just to the south, or the south side of it.
Just missed
pretty
it.
Much just trashed. I believe that's the gym or the area where the kids.
And we're going to briefly interrupt this coverage from KFOR to tell you about a new tornado warning. This is about 20 miles north of Tulsa. This is a tornado warning for Nevada, Osage, and Washington counties. You can see that there is a debris ball here with this particular storm. So another large and dangerous tornado that is now coming towards the Route 75 corridor. Looks like it's going to be moving possibly towards Vera and perhaps just south of Ramona and then more towards Ugala. And you can see here the very well-defined rotational signature that's now just on top of Route 11 and again coming towards Route 75. And it looks like we've got velocities there totaling somewhere around 120 miles per hour, something in that area, so 110 miles per hour. So again, another large and dangerous tornado. This is about 20 miles to the north of Tulsa, and the movement on this cell is off towards the east and northeast, getting it towards Tallala at around 427 and about 433 in Jamestown. So additional dangerous storms across parts of Oklahoma right now. We're going to have more on this coming up in just a few minutes. Do we want to go back now to KFOR's coverage?
This is clearly much more massive in scope in terms of the damage. Geographical area, it's much, much larger. Let's go ahead and take a look at the storm tracker right now. Now, there are quite a few tornado warnings out. We have Mike Bennett on this one. He does not see a tornado warning right now, but it is heading for Meeker and Prague, just to the north of Shawnee. It's just north of I-40, near the Fire Lake Grand Casino right now. It'll track just north of the Shawnee Mall. That has a tornado warning on it right now. And also, severe storms continue in the Midwest City area.
All right, I want to tell you more about some additional tornado warnings that are now south of Oklahoma City as well. Let's take a look at what's going on here on the Doppler radar. And you can see the storm. This is the storm that came through the Moore area, and right now not showing much of a signature on Doppler radar. So certainly that is some better news that at least we are not seeing much rotation on that particular cell. Let's take a look at some of the cells that are farther southward. Tornado warning now for Garvin County. That includes Brady, Elmore City, and also in Foster. You can see the hook echo right there, and I believe that this is the cell that our tornado hunt chase team is now following. That this is south of Oklahoma City and along 35 there, and you can see there is a rotational couplet right here on the southwest side of the cell. Also another cell off to the south of that, well off to the south, another tornado warning on that cell, and we can take a look at that. That is pretty far off to the south into the west in southwestern Oklahoma, and this tornado warning in effect possibly possibly affecting Warika there, as well as Ryan and Sugden, and that is in Clay and Jefferson counties. That is moving towards Route 81. But Brandon, if we could get back to that storm that is to the north of Tulsa, that is the most well-defined storm that we've seen. We had a spotted report of a tornado on that cell, and in addition to that, also looking at a debris ball here. So this is very much the same signature that we saw with that storm that came through Oklahoma City. This is a more rural area, but nonetheless affecting towns that are to about 20 miles to the north of Tulsa, Oklahoma. And you can see again a very well-defined rotational signature here that is now right on top of Route 11, coming towards Route 75. So if you are in the Vera area around the North 4000 Road and south of Ramona, now is the time to get to your safe shelter, as there is most likely a large and dangerous tornado coming your way. We look at it in 3D here. You can see the structure of the supercell storm, and then right in here, this is the tornado that is now again coming towards Route 75, about 20 miles to the north of Tulsa, and moving along towards the east right now at about 20 miles per hour. So it's been just a devastating day across, of course, just south of Oklahoma City. And there are ongoing tornado warnings, and so we may continue to see more of this kind of thing over the next several minutes here. And where do we want to go next, guys? Let's go back over to Kim and Kelly right now.
All right, Carl, we want to show you live pictures right now from our crew. That is, we're thinking this could be along Interstate 35 in Moore, Oklahoma, and emergency vehicles on the scene. Interstate 35 closed in Oklahoma City because of the tornado that moved right across it, taking a direct hit as it moved right across Interstate 35. And as you can see right now, this is KFOR right now looking live at some of the damage in Moore, Oklahoma, and a house fire, thinking this could be a house fire, maybe from a gas leak. And that's why they're urging folks, they're telling folks, you've got to stay home. Stay where you are. Do not go near this area. They need emergency vehicles to get in there. And already the interstates, the roadways are clogged with cars because they had all stopped trying to keep away from the tornado. Now they're trying to get emergency vehicles in here, and they're having a hard time. So please stay away from this area. This is another reason why you need to stay away, because of the gas leaks, and this could happen. And it's hard to get emergency vehicles in here. Fire trucks. Do you see a fire truck in there yet? It's going to be hard for them to get there. We're going to go ahead and listen back to KFOR right now.
We have obviously a plan on where we go, because I'm never going to be there during a storm. So we got a storm shelter. She goes dead. She knows what she's doing. She did text me. She's okay. So that's good news.
That's good. Okay.
I've got some other friends and family here that are okay as well. And I'm hoping the same for the majority of these
people
right here.
Absolutely. I know a lot of your friends and neighbors are around there, John, and you're doing a remarkable job dealing with that emotion, as well as trying to give us the facts and the scope of the damage there.
Has the situation...
As you can see, Kevin, that...
Go ahead, John.
Go ahead, Linda.
Has the situation...
I was going to say, as you can see, that fire right there is just completely engulfing that house, and fire crews can't get there because they've got more important things to do than put out a house fire. One thing that we hope doesn't happen is these houses are, they're probably about 8 to 10, 12 feet away. Well, they're more than 8. They're probably 10 to 12 on that one right there we're showing you. I'm hoping that it doesn't spread to that and then just kind of leapfrog effect. I'm looking back behind us, and there's some heavy rain, but I think it's going to go north. But as you can see, the fire crews are so wrapped up in making sure everybody's safe and trying to get everybody out that they're just letting the house completely burn. That's how the devastation here, you can't even do your basic job because you're doing so much more and trying to help everybody out. This is definitely some of the worst damage I've ever seen in my life. And I've been to a few Middle Eastern countries. This is, especially when this is your hometown, this is where you're from. It's hard to see all this, and these houses are just gone. I mean, the foundation, there's trees, there's nothing. It's just bare ground. It's ripped the grass up even. And if it could have ripped dirt up, I'm sure it did. I bet you the elevation's a few inches lower as this storm just tracked from Newcastle all the way to almost Draper Lake there.
You know, we become somewhat cavalier, John, when we hear these tornado warnings, because you live in Oklahoma, it happens all the time. But when you see the devastation like this, and of course the damage that we saw in yesterday's tornadoes and storms, it reminds you, you have to have a place where you can go underground. It's simply not enough to be in a closet anymore when storms of this magnitude scour their way through our towns and communities and families and neighborhoods.
Well, that's so, and I just put together a story about a fellow who and his family jumped in their closet yesterday with that big tornado that went through. It didn't do much good because the house was picked up and turned upside down, and they're all in the hospital now. So what you said is a very good point. It's amazing that the Warren didn't sustain more damage there, John.
It's over Will Rogers right now. Just let you
he's talking
yeah,
to
he's got a lot going
aeronautical.
On up there.
Tony Beverly runs one of our live trucks. Let's go to him right now. Tony, tell us, first of all, where you are and what you're seeing.
Well, Linda, I'm here off of Southwestern. I'm in between 134 and 149, Southwest 134 and 149. I'm over here near the Orr Family Ranch, and there's just so much devastation over here. Horses everywhere. There are dead horses. There are structures that are on fire. There are structures that are gone. Trees have been uprooted out of the ground. There's fires all over the place. So it's very chaotic out here at this time. I have with me the owner of this Orr Family Farm with me, and he can give us a little bit more assessment as to what's going on here out here in his area as far as his farm is concerned. And so if permitted, I'd like to ask Ms. Dr. Orr here a little bit about what's going on.
Well, it's devastation totally.
Okay, so you run this farm here, sir?
Yes.
Okay, so how many you've lost quite a bit as far as animals? Did everybody get out okay?
Well, as far as we know, so far everybody got out okay. It's just that we have on the Celestial Acres part, we have there's maybe 75 to 100 dead horses and. Okay. And some horses wandering around in a stupor, and then Orr Family Farm, which we have thousands of people come out every year,
okay.
is will be rebuilt, but it right now.
Okay. I want to tell you about this tornado warning that continues here north of the Tulsa area. This is about 20 miles north of Tulsa. Tornado warning for Rogers and Washington counties. And we are still seeing a debris ball on this particular storm. So it's a very well-defined tornado that is now coming right across Route 75. You can see the velocity couplet there showing quite a bit of rotation, very strong rotation now right around the 75, Route 75 region there. And then also coming over into Vera in short order, and we've also been picking up debris on this particular storm. So now it's time to take cover in the Vera area, as well as along of Route 4000 there and 3500. And it looks like it's going to be passing just to the south of Ramona and Brandon. If we can widen the shot just a little bit. I also want to watch out there in Tallala, maybe passing to the north of Oogala. It's passing, moving to the east, but a little north of east. So it looks like it's going to be in Tallala at about 4:30 Central Time, then Jamestown at 4:37 and Wingannon at about 4:42. Another very dangerous storm, most likely a large and violent tornado. Now again, right on Route 75 and making its way over towards Route 169. This is again about 20 miles to the north of Tulsa. And we're going to have more on this as it becomes available coming up here in just a few minutes. Let's get back to K4's coverage of this devastating, absolutely horrible day south of Oklahoma City.
Kids inside there.
All right, this is some of the video we're getting in now of the damage from Moore, Oklahoma, from KFOR. Look at this, complete devastation, completely destroyed. This is live from what I'm hearing. So this completely destroyed, this whatever this is. I know two schools completely destroyed. One, the Plaza Tower School, was an elementary school, and Kelly, possibly some of the students still in there.
We're not sure the status of the kids that were at these schools. We understand that they were hunkering down as the storm was approaching, though. We want to warn everybody, too, that not too far from Moore, there is a severe thunderstorm just on the north side of Moore. Lots of lightning and very heavy rain up towards Oklahoma City, where the kids are now being dismissed and allowed to go home. But again, we're still concerned about more dangerous weather in the vicinity of all this debris that is strewn about.
All right, we're going to listen back into KFOR right now.
The bus routes. So some schools, some schools get out like at 2:15, and then some schools, like Morgan, she has to go, and she stays until like I think 3:40, and they're adjusting it every year. So because of the inflow of the students. So I'm not for sure. We're really getting blown around here. I'm not for sure about times of release for these schools here. So they could have been out for the day.
John, thank you very much. We're going to go to Mike real quickly, but let me invite any parents who may have children in those schools. If your children are safe and you know for a fact that they weren't being sheltered in those schools, please call our newsroom and let us know that so we can pass that information along. We've been unable to confirm whether the children were being sheltered in the schools or whether they had already been released. So help us to know that information.
Unbelievable destruction in Moore, Oklahoma. Damage maybe a mile and a half wide in some cases, and even worse than the 99 tornado that came through on May 3rd back in 99. Again, Kelly, a lot of structures, a lot of businesses completely destroyed. We're getting word even farms that were hit, animals were killed, horses
were
found dead.
Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, we're not sure the status of the schools as far as the kids, if they were in the schools taking shelter, or if maybe they were dismissed by this point. That we are still trying to figure out as we look at this complete devastation by what appears to have been either an EF4, possibly an EF5 tornado that came through here.
Just complete devastation in this area of Moore, Oklahoma. A war zone. I mean, that's the only way you can compare this. And our hearts and prayers just going out to these people. And they're really urging everybody, don't go near this area. You have got to stay away because they've got to get emergency vehicles in here.
Yeah, we're worried about gas leaks. We saw a large fire burning from these aerial shots as well. So obviously fires are a problem that could erupt. And with all that debris everywhere, it's really difficult for the fire trucks to even make their way through the streets. I mean, the roads are just covered. Even the major interstate, Kim, we were watching live at cars just crumpled on even on an interstate.
And thank goodness they had stopped folks from going because it could have been a lot worse. It could have been rush hour traffic. There could have been so many other scenarios that would have made it even worse. Again, Moore, Oklahoma, hit by possibly EF4, EF5 tornado about 4 o'clock. Their time, maybe on the ground for maybe an hour or so, a large wedge tornado, huge debris signatures. You can see why from this devastation, saying that trees were uprooted, pulled out of the ground. Just horrifying.
And as we look at the aftermath of this large tornado in Moore, we want to warn everybody that we're not even done yet. We still have a tornado watch in effect for this area. We are still dealing with active tornado warnings, actually just to the north of Tulsa, Oklahoma. Carl was actually tracking that for us on the radar, and I don't know if Carl is available to talk about it right now, but he was even seeing a debris ball with that particular thunderstorm. Carl, are you there?
Yes, I am. And yeah, we are still looking at a tornado warning here on this cell that is the same cell, actually, that produced the tornado there in Moore. Now, the rotational signature is not nearly as well defined as it once was. You can see that there is some evidence of rotation right in here, but we're not seeing a pronounced rotational signature, and that certainly is some good news. What we are seeing is the presence of large hail with this particular cell. We can take a look at the hail tracker. You can see that core of the hail coming up there towards the 177. It's going to be passing through Meeker or just to the north of Meeker, indicating a golf ball size hail with that particular cell. Also, a lot of lightning with this storm, as you would expect. These supercell storms are very well organized storms, and they continue to roll across areas from just north of Tulsa all the way down to south of Oklahoma City. So there again is the cell that is east of Oklahoma City. That's the same cell that produced this tornado not that long ago. I'm not exactly sure. The exact time of it actually was locally 2:56 to 3:36 local time. So it was on the ground for about 40 minutes. So we're coming up on about an hour since that has happened. So this storm right now, the rotation headed towards Fowler, Jacktown, and Sparks, and Wilzetta. And we have seen these things go through cycles where they get stronger at different periods. So we definitely want to keep a very close eye on this cell. Also, some cells off to the south there, south of Oklahoma City. Still some tornado warnings on those. We've got one, and our tornado hunt team actually very close to this cell. Tornado warning for Garvin. That includes Brady, Elmore City, and Foster. And the area that we're going to watch is right in here. That's the southwest side of the cell. And you can see the rotation right through there near Elmore City. And that's going to be heading up towards Route 29 or a little north of that. So let's get back now to KFOR's coverage in Oklahoma City and see what they're saying about this devastating tornado there.
I do have some definition off to my north and east. I can almost see all the way underneath it, I think, Mike. So I'm not for sure that we've got a funnel all the way in contact with the ground, but Winds are picking up just a little bit here as we're getting closer to the circulation. And I do have a lot of rapid rain with it. So the bottom line is, folks, it created large-scale damage. It's been a long track system so far.
Okay, let's go to the North Doppler control room. I do believe this is on the ground. It's up on those rotating rain curtains. There's Jacktown right there. Here's Highway 62. This is
Meeker. Okay, so we were just watching the coverage there from some of the storm chasers who were following this storm near Meeker. And as we look at it on Doppler radar, we are seeing some evidence of rotation there. You can see right in here some rotation with the cell. There's some cooler air wrapping in right there. There's the inflow notch. So this is the area where we'd be watching for the tornado. If there is one, certainly it's going to be very close to the Meeker area, but not nearly the velocity signature that we saw earlier today. And this is, again, the same cell that came across Moore, Oklahoma. But Brian Norcross is joining me now. And Brian, we've been looking at some of the scenes of devastation there from Moore, and absolutely horrendous. I mean, oftentimes when you see tornado damage, you'll see some areas where houses have been swept off their foundations, you know, maybe a small section of a neighborhood, and from what we saw, it appeared that perhaps there were entire streets that were in that condition.
Yeah, this is going to be a bigger damage path than 1999, and 1999 was spectacular and something that we just so rarely see. I mean, we saw it in Joplin, we saw it in Tuscaloosa, right? Yeah. But this looks like a bigger, wider tornado than we even saw in those cases. We don't know the strength, but just looking at it, when you see every building, even manufactured buildings, being wiped off their foundation and ripped apart, you know that it's at the upper end of the scale. This is Meeker. Now, this is to the west of Prague, Oklahoma. And let's listen in on KFOR.
5 miles, so it's right on top of Meeker right now. So, folks, take your tornado precautions if you're in this area in the path of the storm, because it's been down or already be on the ground and just a rain wrapped and not being able to see it, Mike.
Okay, let's go up to the storm tracker, talk about this storm further south heading for Paul's Valley. Again, it has to be a balance between a continued threat to life and what we have had happen.
All right, so again, we are following this tornado here that is not very far away from Meeker, and you can see right in here, this little notch is where the tornado is located. That's right along 62. Apparently, we're getting some ground confirmation of that. We're not seeing an absolutely tremendous rotational signature on Doppler radar, but nonetheless, we are seeing, at least in the video there, that there very well could be a tornado that is headed towards Meeker. So it's time now to take shelter to get to your safe location in the Meeker area. And I don't know if we can go back to some of the video of the destruction that we saw earlier today in Moore. Now it's just about an hour ago. But Brian, as you mentioned, this was perhaps very different from the Moore tornado that occurred in 1999 because it was so large, maybe looking at a mile and a half wide path. And we saw that as we were watching the video. We saw this incredible lowering, and it's absolutely heartbreaking to see, at least in one section, it looked like there were several streets where the houses may have been cleared away. And that's why, you know, in cases like that, if you're not underground, there's almost no safe place to be.
As they proved in 1999, folks that actually did the right thing unfortunately didn't survive that because their house was completely blown away. Mm. And we saw that in other tornadoes as well. Once they get up into that upper EF4, EF5 range. And by the way, remember the Moore, Oklahoma was tornado in 1999 was the fastest wind speed ever recorded on the earth.
That's right.
Because they happened to have those mobile Dopplers out there.
Yes.
It was early in that technology, and this was the first time they deployed them in that way, and they had over 300 mile an hour winds, first time that's and only time that's ever been recorded. Now, we don't know that that's happened here, but as you said, this is a wider tornado path, and significantly wider, just looks like, from the initial aerials here. And you see the damage there. It looks like Joplin. It looks like in that EF4, EF5 range. It's just hard to imagine that everybody got out of that incredibly wide area. There's I-35. We think that's I-35. We shouldn't say, but that does visually look like I-35.
Yeah, we were.
And that makes sense because we know the tornado came over.
Mm-hmm.
the interstate there and as it moved just south of downtown Moore.
That's right. And we were looking at the velocity signatures from this storm as it was coming right through Moore. It actually was peaking in intensity right over Moore. And the velocity signatures, and we're looking up a few thousand feet in the air when we look at these, they were indicating that the winds were probably around 200 miles per hour. So we know that at least for a time, the winds that were above the ground were somewhere around 200 miles per hour. So it's certainly not a stretch to think that we'd be seeing wind like that on the ground.
You know, we saw those long track tornadoes. We talk about these long track tornadoes. This was not one of them, right?
Yes.
Right? This was actually a very short track tornado. And as you said, very unfortunately, it peaked over the densest population that it went over. It kind of spun up quickly. It just roared to life, essentially, and became a perfect looking, just spectacular looking tornado. And then it dissipated quickly thereafter, but that peak time was over Moore, Oklahoma.
All right, we want to go back now to some of KFOR's coverage.
We're told. We just spoke with Dr. Orr, the owner here, and you could see the entire landscape here. This is 106 acres completely wiped out by the path of this by this tornado that just tracked right through this area. You can't even tell what any of this stuff was. One of the first questions I had for them when I got out here, I said, well, were these homes? What was this? You honestly can't even tell it, but they tell me that these were horse stalls out here where they'd store a ton of these horses. A lot of the animals didn't make it through the storm. And then if you look farther off in the distance, you can see homes that are on the other side of this property. So we're talking about just complete and utter devastation out here. And right now, the people that I've spoken to, a lot of people that are related to the family that runs this farm out here, they're just trying to find some of these animals. A lot of them are in very bad shape. They're going to have to put them down immediately because of just what they went through. But again, when you look across, I mean, if we just kind of pan over here to the left, you can see that plume of smoke. I believe Bob Moore Chopper 4 was over that earlier. And then just you can see the path of how this tornado just kind of came right through here. And it gives you an idea of how wide it was. Because, I mean, from where I'm standing, I'm looking hundreds of yards to the south of me, and I can't even see past the devastation. And it's on every single side of us. So you're talking about just a huge path that this tornado just carved right through the center of this farm here, through residential neighborhoods, and then up right through the heart of Moore, really. And again, if you look off in the distance, you can see some people running out there. They're running to go check on animals. People just keep showing up here in tears. I mean, it is just absolutely heartbreaking. The only thing
you're talking about the devastation. Mike Morgan said at one point that twister was 2.25 miles wide. So that gives us some idea of what you're looking at right now.
And Adam, we also got word that between 75 and 100 horses were killed on that farm. And as you said, many others, unfortunately, will have to be put down especially if they suffer things like broken legs.
Adam, we spoke to Dr. Orr a little bit earlier, and we can see some of the people around there who appear to be employees of Orr Farms. Where did they ride out the twister? Do you have any idea about that yet? I know you just arrived on the scene, but do you know?
Well, when I got here, I immediately spoke to Dr. Orr. He's driving around in a golf cart just surveying the damage, looking for any animals. And he actually had to pull away from us because they'd found some horses that were off in the distance that needed immediate attention. Out here, we can see some law enforcement officers have showed up as well. They're here sporadically. But one of the things we noticed as we were making our way out to this area, the power's knocked out everywhere. So no matter what street you're on, you can't get through. But you just saw this steady stream of police, ambulance, OG&E workers, everyone just trying to get through these areas. I mean, if you could listen real closely, you can almost hear the sirens off in the background. No matter where you're at in this area, it's silence other than the ambulances and the paramedics and the officers just trying to get through here to areas just like this that have been hit extremely hard. I mean, even where we're at right now, I mean, I could see some of the ambulances, some of the firefighters, police way off in the distance. It really, you're lost for words when you see this stuff up close. I mean, luckily, at least here at the farm, what Dr. Orr told me is that there there were no injuries. They must have rode out the storm somewhere safe where they can get underground or that they were away from where this came through here. I'm assuming they told me they've been out here for 40 plus years, so they obviously must have a safe spot that they could go to in times like this. And so luckily, from what the doctor told me, that no injuries, at least to some of his workers or families. So he has nothing to report on that. But again, when you look out here and you kind of just see, you can't see past any of the damage. I mean, even right where we're at, I'm shocked when they told me that these were horse stalls, because it just, it could have been a house. You really can't tell the difference between any of this stuff out here because it's completely wiped away. It's almost like
We want to come back to you, but we've gotten some more information about the schools, and of course people are very frantic.
We want to hear actually about what happened with the schools. Can we go back to that real quick?
Now, we can confirm and know for a fact that 2:45, a message was sent to parents on the internet saying we are currently holding all students with the current storm danger until this current storm danger is over. Students are being released to parents only at this time. We will notify you by the same method when students are released, when the student release begins. You need to put this in context. There's no way for these people to communicate down there very much. The Moore administration building, we're told, was also damaged, so they're going to have difficulty getting word out of that. We have not confirmed any of this with Moore School Administration, but
we unfortunately think that some kids were in those two buildings because of the lockdown order and because of what we're getting from our news desk right now. We will, of course, continue to update you on that just as quickly as we can on that. Right now, let's go to Lance West.
All right. Again, very sad news to report there. They do believe that kids were in those two schools that were destroyed by that tornado. We've been wanting to get confirmation about what was going on with dismissal of these kids. An elementary school was plastic. The Tower Elementary was demolished, basically, and another school as well. We're not sure of the name of it, but very horrible news.
Underground shelter. Hopefully. In those schools, you know, we sure hope so. We want to show you some new video coming in of some of the damage. I believe we have some of this. There we go. Now we're going to listen back into KFOR.
I've never seen anything like this in my 18 years covering tornadoes here in Oklahoma City. This is without question the most horrific.
Lance, listen, we need to get this information. We understand what you're looking at and how horrific it is, but you are telling us that you have confirmed that children were in the Plaza Tower Elementary School, that the gentleman you were just talking to was pulling out third graders. Is that correct?
That is correct. I'm racing over there as quickly as I can.
All right.
And they did a lot of people trying to help.
All right, Lance, they're pulling third graders out. We hope that, of course, they were in their tornado positions, and hopefully that some of them are going to be okay. Lance is on his way over there right now. You got to understand, when you go down to these scenes and you see this firsthand, not just through the prism of the television, but when you're there living it, it is an extremely emotional event for reporters as well as all those involved. And Lance is one of our best reporters, Emmy Award winning reporter, and he's going to get that information for us, but he's human just like the rest of us, and it is a devastating sight to see these kind of things.
Mike Morgan, we're looking at earlier video of the storm that moved into Moore, but that storm is not finished yet. Tell us where it is now.
It is not. It's over by Meeker, and our storm tracker Mark Dillard still has a tornado on the ground on the northwest side of Meeker. Urgently right now, I have to pass this along to you. With this tornado warning now for Garvin County, this is a rapidly developing tornado that could be significant in size. There is a tornado warning in effect for Paul's Valley. It is heading directly for Paul's Valley. And we do have Reed Timmer. Reed Timmer is on that storm right now, and we'll be checking back with him. But if you're in Paul's Valley, it is heading directly into town, as you can see right now, 4:42 or before. And then from there, it's going to head on up towards Stratford at 5:11. That is a intensifying supercell circulation, which appears to be a tornado either on the ground or developing to the ground right now. Reed Timmer is on it, but it is heading directly for Paul's Valley. That is an immediate tornado warning for you in Paul's Valley. Valley. Let's go to the North Doppler radar. Look at Meeker. Mark Dillard still has a tornado on the ground here. This is on the northern side of Meeker.
All right, we want to get you up to date on some of these tornado warnings that are ongoing here. That cell that produced the tornado and more still producing a possible tornado near Meeker. Tornado warning now for Lincoln County that includes Chandler and Meeker and Sparks. And that rotation is going to be right around here on the southwest side of the cell. So right near Meeker and right along Route 62 and traveling now to the east at about 20 miles per hour. Also got a couple of rotating storms to the south of Oklahoma City. One that is well to the south and a storm coming towards Paul's Valley and along 35. So we'll take a look at that. And you can see the well-defined hook echo there. And that is now coming into 35 in Paul's Valley. So heads up there in Garvin and McLean counties for a possible large tornado coming your way. Seeing rotation there in the signature just west of 35 right in here. Broad rotation, looks like a tighter rotation right there now, just off towards the west of east of 1582 road. So again, heads up in Paul's Valley for a possible tornado, most likely tornado coming your way and towards 35. And we also have a storm that is now just to the north of the Tulsa area. We've been watching that. Let's take you south. First of all, tornado warning for Jefferson County, Cornish and Ringland and Ryan counties. A big supercell storm, well-defined couplet there, velocity signature that is now north of 32, and some of the towns in the path of that is now east of Ryan. It looks like it's going to be generally headed towards Ardmore and 35 as it lifts a little bit to the north of east, as we have been seeing again and again this afternoon. I want to bring in Brian Norcross once again and talk about some of what we have seen across the region. Maybe we can bring up some of those pictures of the tornado. And Brian, this is going to probably go down as one of the worst tornadoes in American history. I fear that the loss of life in this case may really be tremendous.
It's hard to imagine that everybody got out of there. Mm-hmm. Because it's just so big, yeah. Right? And very unfortunately, when we saw the aerials, we didn't see a lot of people moving around, right? Yeah. That sometimes you see.
Right.
And it was wider than the Joplin tornado, estimating a half a mile or so wider. Mm-hmm. And in terms of intensity, it just looked like Joplin again,
yeah.
Right? And so depending on the structures, now the good thing is in Oklahoma, there's no place with tornado plans and tornado structures and tornado culture like Oklahoma City, like that area,
yeah,
and
right.
Oklahoma in general. So, I mean, that's, you know, that's what we hope, but it's just, I don't know, you don't want to say until you know, right?
Sure.
And we know that they're doing their search and rescue now, and we're going to know pretty soon. You know, a pretty good version of what's happened, but you don't want to speculate.
Yeah, and I don't know if we can take a look at some of the damage aerials that we've been getting from K4, but the damage has been tremendous. There was a school that was hit, and we did get word that there may have been children in that school at the time, that the school was actually holding the children for their safety, and so they may have been inside, and it did appear that that school was severely damaged. Then we looked at a number of pictures of damage to neighborhoods, and we saw some areas where there had been quite a few homes that appeared to have been swept clean from their foundations. And you can only imagine that in cases where people did not have an underground shelter, and in that case, that they most likely the toll is going to be very high in that area.
Well, you know of at least two schools that were hit. Now, it's a little confusing mm-hmm. because I heard a guy from Moore, Oklahoma, an official from Moore, Oklahoma, say they wasn't sure everything that happened in the schools because at least some of the schools or one of the schools was outside of the city of Moore, and so that's a different school district there. So exactly what's happened in those schools remains foggy, but we have heard that there is a rescue operation going on. I'm sure there's rescue operations going on at both schools, but we know specifically from KFOR that the elementary school there, they were rescuing children just a moment ago. We heard from KFOR.
Right. We want to go now to Jim Cantori. He is actually going into Moore. He's joining us on the phone right now. And Jim, this is just really, really difficult. This is, you know, we're all fascinated by weather at the Weather Channel, but this is as hard as it gets, seeing this level of devastation, which we know has occurred today.
You know, Carl, as much of an adrenaline rush as I had yesterday with you on the phone when we were, you know, coming in and chasing those tornadoes out in the middle of nowhere, really ever since last night when Shawnee got hit, and certainly now with what's happened around Moore, I mean, it, you know, I feel awful. And we're heading back to Moore right now to, you know, join certainly the fray of coverage. We'll bring you the best story that we can. We are probably about 60 miles to the south. We went after the southern storms, and even though, you know, the storm started to rotate back and more, we stayed on the southern storms. And now, you know, just turning around and getting out of these areas, these rural areas, is not that easy. But we're heading back to more, and we'll let you know, guys, what we find when we get there. My heart goes out to everybody, certainly in the last couple of days, that has been dealing with these devastating tornadoes. Carl, back to you.
All right, Jim, thank you so much. And we were just taking a look at some of those pictures of the devastation. I don't know if we can actually bring that video back that we had just moments ago. That was the video showing some of the houses there that had been swept off their foundations. Here you see the cars that have been piled up. This is, I believe, this is right next to one of these schools that we were looking at. And you can see how the cars just piled up. They've been pushed into the school, essentially. And you know, the velocities that we were talking about in this case, Brian, are probably going to be on the order of the highest that we see when we talk about tornado wind speeds.
Yeah, I mean, just looking at it, it looks like EF5. Mm-hmm. I mean, and the way we talk about tornadoes, the same way we talk about hurricanes, is EF5 is just everything at the high end, right? We don't really, because we can't measure the winds. All right, back to KFOR.
Yeah, it certainly is.
Physically, do you feel lucky? I mean,
I feel pretty lucky. Yeah, feel pretty lucky.
What did you see the tornado coming up on top of you here?
I didn't see nothing. You know, like I say, I couldn't hear no sirens. I couldn't hear nothing, and then it was real windy, and then all of a sudden everything just stopped. And being from Oklahoma, I said, you know, that's not right. And so when I looked outside, I seen the debris flying over here, and I said, it's time. And I tried to let some horses go, and that's all there was.
And so it's Lando?
Lando.
Height?
Yes, sir.
H?
H-I-T-E.
Lando, if you mind staying with me for a second, because this is just the fact that you're almost outside and all this, we're actually going to take this in a second live, and it's kind of, that was like a practice run.
Okay.
And we'll have you. Have you kind of just rehashed it for me? I can hear you. Yeah.
All right, so that was at that Orr family farm. That was the southwest of Moore on the other side of I-35, not far outside of town, but it's a landmark there on the south side of Oklahoma City, and obviously someone working there and for whatever reason wasn't aware. Maybe out in that, all right, let's go back. We'll go back to KFOR.
And those parents waiting to hear word, my goodness. That's Plaza Towers, right, Lance?
That is correct. We're Plaza Towers. Okay. And everything within a square mile of this school has just been decimated by this storm.
Lance, are parents being kept back, or are they working to look for their children?
They are not allowing the parents to get onto the debris pile. Obviously, way too dangerous. There are downed power lines, debris everywhere with nails, gas leaks, things like that. But there are parents who are trying to make it in here. We fortunately were able to follow some emergency vehicles and get access, but most of the folks have been stopped about a mile back from the destruction zone.
Have you seen children removed from the debris who have been transported?
We just saw one child, and he's standing now. It looks like he's hugging someone, maybe his parent, but we have only seen one child that has been transported. We have seen other people, other victims transported from here in the backs of pickup trucks. There are some four-wheel drives that are maneuvering in. I'm looking at a Jeep right now that seems to have clearance and was able to make it into this area.
All right.
But for the most part, it's very limited access for the average citizen to get in here. They're going door-to-door searching these homes, searching storm shelters. We met a family as they were coming out of their shelter. And they were just devastated. They said that their neighbors were pounding on the door to get in as the tornado came in, and they didn't have the strength to open the door because the wind was so devastating. They don't know what happened to their neighbors.
And Lance, we want to verify this again. You're telling us that 75 children were in class when that storm hit Plaza Towers, and they believe those 75, they're searching for all of them right now. Is that correct?
That is what I'm being told by one of the rescuers here on the scene, that there were 75 people inside that building in the hallway, which was the secure place, the safe environment, the tornado shelter, if you will. But the walls are gone, cinder block walls that are 8 inches thick, and the roof is completely gone. It basically looks like it just collapsed in on itself, and There are search and rescue personnel on top of this 10-foot mountain of debris going through the pile, screaming for victims. So we're not anything, but we can only hope that they can search and that they continue to yield some positive results.
Absolutely.
And we do need some hopeful news. And you did tell us, for those just joining us, we're talking about the Plaza Towers Elementary School. 75 children believe, and staff members believe, to be in the school when the tornado hit. They were sheltering in the hallway, which was deemed their safe spot. There is no safe spot above ground for an F5 if this turns out to be that. But Lance, you were saying that you saw at least one child who came out of the debris and was hugging a parent or somebody. Is that correct?
That is correct. A young man, probably about 8 to 10 years old, I would say.
Okay, well, that's a good sign, Lance, if they were all there together.
Loaded. I told you about that Jeep, that four-wheel drive. She's being loaded into that Jeep right now very gingerly, and she will be taken out of here. Also talked to a gentleman by the name of Pat Smith. He has a child in the school, pulled his child out 10 minutes before the tornado hit, and then came back to help in the search and rescue efforts. And he told me that they pulled out 30 kids alive, but the search continues for even more.
All right.
Okay, so you're saying of the 75 who were sheltered in that school, 30 were pulled out alive? Is that what you're saying?
I do know that there were 30 pulled out. I don't know if there's still 75 more in there or if we can track those 30, okay. But I was told that there were some 75 in that area when the storm hit.
All right.
Be very careful with this information. Yes.
Right. All right,
yeah,
Lance.
I mean, obviously, I'm going to continue to get more information from the folks out here. This is all very preliminary.
Right. Lance, we appreciate your effort as a parent yourself and those parents like us watching. It is a very difficult assignment that our Lance West has right now, but nothing compared to what those families are going through at this point.
Adam Mertz is on the scene as well in a different part of Moore. Let's go back to him right now. Adam?
Yeah, Linda, we're at Orr Family Farm, and I just spoke to a couple people who've been out here, and they say that some people were able to make it to a basement in one of the houses over here, but there were a lot of people who had to ride out this storm incredibly. They rode it out inside of these horse stalls, and one of those people that did this, Lando Height. Lando, describe for me the moments that this tornado came through here and what was going on.
Well, you know, it was all windy and stuff before the tornado came. I had no idea it was coming. It was just figured it was just like yesterday, you know, a big storm coming, and then all of a sudden it went quiet. And when it did that, being from Oklahoma, I came outside to see, and I seen debris flying over that way, and I thought I might have had a little while. So I tried to let some of the horses get, you know, loose and free out of their stalls so they'd have a chance. I didn't have very long at all, and I jumped into one of the stalls here, and that's what these here used to be, and they collapsed over on top of me, and sat a pickup truck on top of it, and pushed it down this here cement way, and you know, it was just unbearably loud, and you could see stuff flying everywhere, just about like on the movie Twister, you know.
So you jumped into a stall, and how far did this push you? I mean, where'd you start off, and where'd you end up?
Oh, approximately 100 feet of push, just or so. If, I don't know if the camera can hit it or not, but there you see the back of a red pickup truck, Dodge Ram, sitting down the shed row there, and it pushed us approximately about 100 yards, or just slid us down the cement here. You know, it's.
And was it just you in there?
It was just me, as far as I know. I was the only one over here in this barn. So far, it seems to be there's one person unaccounted for from in this barn. Everybody else, you know, was either already gone for the day or stayed over in a different barn. But you know, I stay here with the horses all the time. I'm an exercise rider, and I'm also the caretaker for Mark Lee.
Well, and that's the thing. If we could walk over here, you were telling me that this right here is basically where you lived. Yeah. So you not only worked here, this is where you lived.
Yes. You know, they used to have the saddles and everything over here. These were tack rooms. And this tack room here is where I used to live at. This here, you know, as you can see, my belongings. And then a couple fans for in the shed row, and you know, it's just, it's lost everything.
What's going through your mind right now? I mean, you just survived something that a lot of people probably wouldn't. You were outside when this happened. You've lost everything. I mean, has it even set in yet? I mean, how are people out here? How are they doing?
Well, the main thing is the horses. You know, it's these horses are how we survive. You know, it's
These horses are what bring us our meals every day, what bring us our place to sleep, and we might have one horse left out of all of them, and, you know.
Well, and that's the thing when you look out here. Describe for people what it looked like before. I mean, what would we have been looking at out here?
Well, basically, if you take a look at this here barn, there was four of them, one here, one down there, one right there, and another one down there.
So what we're looking at here is what the barns used to look like. This, and there were, I believe, six of those out here is what I was told.
Yes, yes, and then this was the racetrack. And there was approximately 80 head of horses or so stabled at this facility.
So so where we're standing now would have been one of those stalls,
yes,
there.
Yes, where we were standing is, as you look right here, each little spot, there was from here to that what used to be a stall door, there was, you know, two stalls right there. And on each side of these were stalls all the way down. On every barn. And
well, Lando, I do appreciate your time, and certainly if you need anything, we'll be out here, all right, and just holler, all right? But again, when you look at this, there really is nothing much left out here. Like I said, the Orr family told me that they were able to get inside their house. It's a three-level house with a basement, so the family members, they were able to get down there. They tell me that they rent out these stalls, so that's why they really don't know how many people may have been out here at the time that this tornado came through here, because people kind of come and go as they please. So, again, people like Lando, who is out here, he works out here, he lives out here, honestly had no idea that this tornado was coming. It was just his, like, a sixth sense where he noticed that, you know, everything got quiet and immediately reacted to that. And Linda Kevin, it more than likely saved his life.
Yeah, well, obviously the case, but we've been on the air since 2:30 giving live broadcasts on the progress of that storm. So please keep in mind that if you know someone in one of these areas affected, please call them and let them know. For some reason, they might not be watching television, may not be alerted. It's critical that people have this information so that they can seek cover. Obviously, he did, but many others did not.
75 to 100 horses killed out there on that farm.
We need to update the Plaza Towers Elementary as well.
All right, we've been watching KFOR's coverage there in Oklahoma City, and got a new tornado warning to tell you about that is well off to the south and west of Dallas and Fort Worth, but cells developing now south and west of Dallas and Fort Worth. So we're going to want to keep our eyes on this. And right now, tornado warning for Brown County, including Blanket and Birds, and also May. And that cell now moving off towards the east at about 25 miles an hour. You can see that there is a well-defined rotational signature there, right along 183 and also along 387. Don't know if we've got some of the video from earlier today. And if you are just joining us and just hearing about this for the first time, a major tornado hitting Oklahoma City earlier. It happened between 2:56 and 3:36 local time, central time, on the ground for about 40 minutes. The devastation has been tremendous. The path, the damaged path, as much as 2 miles wide in some spots. We've seen entire neighborhoods that have been devastated. A couple of schools have been involved. We are hearing that some areas where children were sheltering were significantly damaged. We're not sure about casualties in those areas, but this is no doubt going to be one of the worst tornadoes that we have seen in American history when all is said and done. And the threat not over yet, as we are still watching a number of supercell thunderstorms now across parts of Oklahoma. And we'll have more on that coming up in just a moment. Let's get over to Alex Wilson now with some new information.
Well, Carl, you know, you were just referencing the elementary schools that were damaged today in those Oklahoma City areas, really South Oklahoma City into the Moore area. And one of the schools that we are hearing about is the Plaza Towers School. This appears to be a K-6 or pre-K, basically, through sixth grade. So this is an elementary school. We're talking about kids up to about the age of 12 years old. This is on Southwest 11th Street, so it is just off to the west of Interstate 35. This would be one of the harder hit areas. And you can see, looking at this footage, the city is almost on a grid. We have the streets and then at right angles the other streets. So it's looking like a grid system with the neighborhoods, schools in between. This isn't too far from the Warren Theater that did see significant damage. Also, the Moore Medical Center is nearby to this Plaza Towers School. But we are hearing reports about 75 students and teachers that were seeking shelter. Again, this storm hit around 3:30 local time. We are going to look at video. I'm sorry, what was that? That's right. We have the video. This is the area roughly where this Plaza Towers school was, and you can see these grids basically just wiped out, these neighborhoods in between these major streets that would go in between the neighborhoods. That Plaza Towers school around this area, again, Southwest 11th Street, about 75 students and teachers were sheltering in, and you can see there is some of that video of that school just decimated. And look at some of these homes around the area just completely ripped apart. Now, likely this was coming around the time that the school would have let out. This would have been 3:30 about local time, so most likely an elementary school either getting ready to let out or soon letting out. So most likely these kids were being held. Many of the local schools have finally begun to let kids go. We have seen reports of Westmore High School beginning to dismiss students, other Oklahoma area or Oklahoma City area schools dismissing. Now, there is a search and rescue area at the Warren Theater parking lot. This is very close to that Plaza Tower school. Now, as we heard from the KFOR coverage, it did seem like about 30 children, according to one witness, had been pulled out of the debris of this Plaza Tower school. No word on whether or not they were seriously injured or not. That witness just said he had seen about 30 people. No word if that goes into the 75 students and teachers that were seeking shelter, or if that's in addition to the 75 students and teachers that they were going to continue to look for. But that search and rescue is nearby at that Warren Theater parking lot that did also sustain some serious damage. And you can see as we look at some of the video, most likely some parents looking for their kids as they head over to the area. Now, officials have said try not to head into that area because it's still very unsafe to do so. But we are watching, I'm sure, some very nervous parents going and looking for their children at that Plaza Tower school. And when we talk about a pre-K through sixth grade school, we're obviously talking about very young children, pre-K starting around four or five up to the sixth grade, which would be about 12th grade or 12-year-old. So some young children most likely trapped in this building as those rescuers head out. And as we look at some of that aerial footage, you can see what does appear to maybe be some young children. You can see a little girl in a pink sweater, also some young children with maybe parents nearby. Now, as parents continue to look for people, one of the nearby areas, again, that people are heading to is the Warren Theater. That's a local search and rescue area. So officials have said, please stay out of Warren off the roads. We most likely still have the power lines. Things are very treacherous around the Moore area. Kids were in school at the time, so they were seeking shelter, we heard, in their hallway. A lot of times here we do say that that's the safest place to head to, that most interior level, those hallways often without the windows. So a lot of times you hear of your children going to the school drills, or if you're a teenager, you know that your school takes you in for those tornado drills. You sit in the hallway, you put your head on your lap, and you huddle up into a ball. Unfortunately, as we take a look at some of this footage of these complete neighborhoods just decimated, unfortunately, I know a lot of people worried about the worst with the students in the Plaza Towers school. Another school that we are hearing about that could have seen some significant damage, Briarwood Elementary. Several reports coming out that this was the other city or other school, and this also is a pre-K to sixth grade school. So unfortunately, both of the schools that were hit did school very young children. No word on injuries there, how many people may or may not be trapped, whether or not there were students there at the time. But the Plaza Towers school, the one that we are looking at the damage in and around the area of, this apparently reportedly did have 75 students and teachers, and those search and rescue efforts will continue around there. We're going to continue to watch this, Kim and Kelly, and we will update you on the latest as this turns into a very big story around the Oklahoma City and Moore area, as a search and rescue will obviously be the top priority as we go through the next few hours and perhaps days.
All right, thanks, Alex. Good information there, and it's just very tough pictures to see, especially being a parent, right, and hearing about these schools. And if you're just joining us, a major tornado destroying parts of Moore, Oklahoma, and now we're getting word of several hundred people now being treated at the Warren.